So let's now face the issue that we already faced when we talk with the Invisible model, which is the obtention of the tangent algorithmic tangent operators. And now we talk about the consistent or algorithmic, there are two names for the same, tangent operator. What do we have now? Look, the question that we are facing is an equation in which, as I told you, we already commented on that, the stresses depend on time, not only through t, through epsilon to the strains, but also additionally. Okay? So that what we talk, what we define as the tangent, and that is the analytical tangent operator, is just the derivative of these stresses with respect to that epsilon. Okay? No reference to the dependence of the stresses with respect to this additional argument t. And of course we obtain that since after some, that's something that we already proven, that that analytical tangent operator for the viscous damage case is 1 minus d times c. That's something that we already proved. This is, in fact, is the second operator, as we said, the second operator, because it's the result of affecting the elastic tangent constitutive operator by the factor 1 minus d. So this is what is the analytic tangent operator, okay? But of course now we are interested in something else, which is the differentiation of the integrated stresses with respect to the integrated strains. So that is what we will need. That's something to be proven, but I anticipate that what you will need to linearize the problem, the nonlinear problem of nonlinear solid mechanics, is to obtain the derivative of the integrated stresses with some errors. There is some error here with respect to the strains at every time step. That differentiation is what we call the algorithmic tangent operator, also called consistent. Why the word consistent? Because that algorithm is consistent with the integration, numerical integration algorithm that we have used. If we use another tangent in numerical integration or another time step or whatever the parameter that can change the results of the integration algorithms, which are, I insist again, approximate, then, of course, if we change that, we'll obtain different results. And we will obtain different values. So this depends typically on the parameters of integration. This result will depend on this result, and the result depends on the alpha, on the eta, on the delta t, etc. But what we differentiate here is consistent with that. And since what we are going to introduce in the nonlinear problem is this, not the theoretical solution, but the integrated solution, then we need something which is consistent with that. I anticipate that we are not using that. We use that. And that they can be, and they are in fact, we'll see immediately, different. They don't have to be exactly the same. And using that instead of that seriously affects the performance of the linearization Newton-Raphson-like method that they use for solving the problem. Keep this message. Any error in computing that, for instance, replacing that by that, seriously affect the robustness, the convergence of the nonlinear problem. You don't know yet what is the convergence and what is the nonlinear problem, but just keep this message. We have to take that one, okay? So now we know that one, very easy, but that's not the one that we need. We need that one. We have to differentiate the integrated stresses that depend on the strength through what? Well, they depend on the strains here, but also since these depend on R, and R depends on epsilon, so and D depends on Q and R, whatever, with these this nest that we have done, finally the integrated value of the damage variable at time step n plus 1 depends on the current value of the computed value of the strain at this time step. So we have to differentiate that. Look, what is inside this formula? Well, the stresses depend on the strains and the damage. The damage model depends, the damage variable depends on R, and R depends on epsilon through what? Well, after that, we see that depends on tau epsilon n plus alpha, which depends on epsilon n plus 1. So there is a dependence of R and then D on through epsilon, and also a dependence here. And at when doing this differentiation, we have to consider both dependencies. Okay? So an easy way of doing that is through differentiation, in the sense that I consider a differential of stresses considering all dependence with respect to the strains, considering all dependence of the strains in the formula. So looking at that, when I differentiate the stresses, I have to differentiate the strains here. So that's this part here. 1 minus d times c times the differential of the strains. But then there is another dependence of the strains here, algorithmically, which I have to consider, and then I have to first take derivative of d with respect to r. Let's call it d prime. And then differential of r. Times that open or tensorial product, times this, which by the way is what we call effective stresses. So finally, and look, how is this differential of r? Well, we have it here. Differential of r is 0 in elastic unloading, because they don't depend on the current, on the strains at epsilon n plus 1. It's constant. But the differential of r with respect to strains is through that. So you have to differentiate that with respect to epsilon and consider this factor. So that's what we are considering. So the norm of the strains has this shape. Differentiating with respect to the strain is 1 over the norm times, and this can be summarized as epsilon c delta epsilon. We have done that several times. And this is the effective stresses, so this can be written in that way. Differential of tau is 1 over tau times sigma effective times differential of epsilon. Okay, now, differential of stresses I need to place. This term here, which is that derivative here, times differential of epsilon, I'm just taking differential of epsilon out of the parentheses. So this term correspond times this differential of epsilon to that. And now I have to place a second term which comes from here. Let's see what happens here. D prime is here. Then dr implies the computation of that delta t, differential of t, which in fact is 1 over tau, times 1 over tau times here, the effective stress, which is here, times delta epsilon. Delta epsilon, sorry, is here. And then this term here, alpha delta t divided by eta plus alpha delta t, is this term here. Okay? So finally, by doing these operations, we can express differential of sigma as 1 minus d times c delta epsilon. This also only happens in the case of elastic unloading. Or that, which immediately we can recognize as the second constitutive operator, minus something. And this something is all here that multiplies the delta epsilon. And this is the algorithmic tangent operator. So we have two different tangent operators, algorithmic tangent operators. One for elastic or unloading cases, which coincides with the second operator, taking into account that dn plus 1 is equal to dn, doesn't change. And in the cases of loading, we have to subtract to this term one other term that comes out from the dependence of t through epsilon, which involves all this computation here. Not so complicated. It's just this term that involves delta t, so depends on the error, on the increment of time, depends on alpha, depends on eta, the viscosity, And this d' prime depends on the loading that wouldn't be, and then the product, the double product of the effective stresses, where this d' prime, again, can be written in terms of a hardening, softening modulus, etc., etc. So everything is in here to compute the algorithmic tangent operator at time step n plus 1 for the Biscoe-Davet model. There are two different branches. One, if at this time the problem is in elastic loading, the point is in elastic loading or neutral loading, then is that. And if it's in loading, then the algorithmic tangent operator is there. And this has to be done, and it has to be coded perfectly. Otherwise, you are paying for it, believe me. Okay? And then, is it also possible that during the assignment, if you don't do the right thing, the proper things, you will see problems with that. Okay? No, not maybe in this assignment, but maybe in other assignments. Look, what happened with this term? This second term, which is modifying the tangent operator, which is, by the way, the second operator, which is, by the way, that analytic tangent operator, 1 minus d minus c, that is modified for the logarithmic in something that is subtracting here. But look, this subtraction depends on delta t. When delta t tends to 0, that term becomes 0. So in the limit, the tangent constitutive operator, analytical and algorithmic, consistent algorithmic, collapse into each other. In the limit, when delta t tends to 0. But you never go into the limit. We also have different delta t different from 0. And this makes a strong difference in the convergence of the Newton-Raphson algorithm. If you do that properly or not, you are paying for it. You cannot forget that. That's the message. Okay? Any question? That's one of the first. You remember that in the Visin model, we also derived one tangent operator in elastic unloading and in loading. But they were not different. They were not different from the analytical model. They were the same. In this case, the tangent constitutive operator, algorithmic and analytical, are different. One doesn't introduce that, the analytical. The consistent introduces this second term here. Okay? That's the final picture. Look, what happened, this is algorithmic viscous damage, algorithmic tangent operator at time step n plus 1. Look, for elastic unloading, for loading. What happens if alpha is equal to 0? This term disappears. Okay? So for explicit integration, that term disappears, and the algorithmic and analytic tangent operator, they collapse into each other. They are the same. For explicit, that's somehow is an advantage, a little advantage of explicit methods, that you don't have to introduce the second part of the algorithmic operator because this one disappears. What happens as delta t tends to 0? I already commented on. That term disappears. So again, that's consistency. In the limit of delta t tends to 0, the algorithmic and the analytical tangent operator, they collapse into each other. Naturally, for the explicit method, what do you consider in alpha, in the explicit method, alpha equals 0? Yes. This term disappears, that's out.
But you were saying that it's really important to consider.
No, I said that you have to use your tangent algorithmic, which is consistent with the integration method you use. So this is the general expression for a consistent tangent operator. Now it can be specified by different cases. For alpha equals 0, that term drops, and then it doesn't matter if I had or not forgotten this, because that is not playing any role for alpha equals 0. But for alpha different from zero, this is playing a role.
But it will be saying that it behaves in the same way for elastic, that unloading or neutral loading, that for loading.
Yeah. Yeah. That's as it is. Look, that doesn't. I mean, I think this can look some controversial, but we saw that analytically, the analytical tangent operator, which is that, is the second. So it doesn't distinguish between loading and unloading. But look, that tangent operator in the viscous case doesn't include all dependencies on time. There is another part that we already commented on that is the one responsible that being different, the loading and unloading, when you look at the evolution. So one thing is the strict definition of the tangent operator as the derivative of sigma with respect to epsilon. Another thing is as what would be sigma dot, the evolution with time. Well, there is a second term that we have to consider too. But as for the seventh thing, it's the same in the limit. It's the same in the analytic case or even in the explicit case. Not even for the logarithmic in the explicit case. But as we have in other cases, or cases other than an analytical one, then this term is there. And you have to consider it. Third case, what happens when eta is equal to zero? The implicit case. Well, this term goes, and this term is going to one. And what do we obtain? This solution here. What is this? What we obtain for the tangent operator in the rate-independent case, in the implicit case. So again, we see that I could just code this solution and specifying alpha eta equals zero for obtaining eta zero, and we already know that alpha equals one for the integration case, and then I can obtain the solution both for the stresses and for the tangent operator, the solution of the implicit case, just by specifying alpha equal one and eta equals zero in the viscous case. In other words, both for everything that I need, that is the stresses and the tangent operator, I just need to code the viscous case, and then I will obtain the implicit solution just by a specific case. Okay? Another point that you could make a mistake is by the reason if you divide by eta, for instance, sometimes you can be tempted of divided by eta the numerator and by eta the denominator. In that case, if you take eta equals zero, the computer will answer with error. Okay? So that is the way to code it. It's a way that I can put eta equals zero with no error, no number, or whatever is the message. Okay? Well, so now we have arrived to the end of the story. What should I effectively put into my code to be able of computing the stresses, the constitutive equation, stresses versus strain, so for every strain obtain the stresses, and the corresponding tangent of an operator in both viscous and implicit cases. Okay? And here is the algorithm.